Smith.
Here.
Vice Mayor Lewis.
Here.
Chair Polito.
Here.
Vice Chair Massey.
Here.
Mr. Lee is excused out of country. Mr. Houseman.
Close the door.
See if he shows up. Mr. Dillabo.
Yep.
Any public comment? Mr. Massey, any public comment?
No comment today.
He promised me.
It's a first.
He wasn't.
Next item on the agenda is to review and approve the draft minutes for September 15th meeting. I didn't see anything.
Hey, you're so moved.
Incorrect.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We're not voting.
Ms. Cullen, you're on.
Thank you.
Actually, Robert and probably want to do a little.
Oh, yeah, real quick. As you all know, we every year we try to do a property tax analysis, and the town of Atherton hires HDL to do this for us every year. So Mrs. Cohen is here to present to us the overview for 15-16. In my staff report, I had mentioned that the assessed value in 11-12 was $6.3 million. This year at 15-16 is now $8.7 million. And a change over last year was $722 million. And we'll go from there because I don't want to steal Paula's thunder.
Robert, is you?
Thank you.
And I'm not sure if you got a copy of the review, and if you do, you can look at it closer. If not, okay. I just want to comment that the upper left-hand box on that report, which is this box here, talks about the things that happened, the events that happened that caused the $722.6 million increase. So when I was on the plane this morning, I was figuring out what percentage the big items were to see that they totaled up. I'm going to walk over here and talk loud. The largest, one of the larger increases was the change in the CPI. And as you're aware, with Prop 13, we can have a maximum of 2% change in the value every year. The CPI for 15-16 was 1.998, so we did not hit that 2%. The CPI for next year, 16-17, we've been tracking from October 2014 through August. We've got to get to October 2015. But October through August was 1.54%. It's not going to be 2%. My guess here is somewhere 1.7%. So it's going to be a little bit less than last year.
How's that number produced?
It's all wage earners, state of California.
Mm-hmm.
All urban and non-urban, whatever the other is, together for the October, the prior year through October, the current year.
Hmm.
And the CPI is released every other month, so August was the last month it was released. We'll get the new release in October. The assessors make that known. It's the same CPI every county throughout the state. They make that known in late December.
Oh, so it's the CPI. I didn't realize it. Okay.
Yeah. And per Prop 13, it can be 2% if mm-hmm. it is greater than 2%, or if it doesn't hit 2%, it's whatever the actual CPI is.
Got it. All right.
So that amount added $133.7 million to the roll. You'll notice that last year, the total value under the date was a little more than $8 billion. This year, it's 8.7. Looking at the value last year, in order to move the city property taxes up 1%, we have to find $80 million in new value. So looking at what the CPI did last year, it added 1.65%, not quite 2%. The next large item are the transfers of ownership, and my goodness. You're the last city in this county that I've delivered. And of course, everybody is seeing that your median prices are $5 million plus, and they're just kind of going, shaking their heads, going, whoa, how can people afford there? But the properties here, we're finding properties that were purchased back in 1978 worth $300,000 selling for $8.6 million. I mean, just somebody finally cashing out. Mm-hmm. You know, it's incredible. And when that happens, that differential between what the value was and what the sale price is gets added on the prior year transfers of ownership. So of your 8.9%, half of it had to do with property selling for more than the assessed value in town. Last year, we had a little bit of recapturing of Prop 8. So you don't have a lot left out there. So it totals about half a percentage point. We saw About $47 million added, and that was about a half a percentage point.
What was Prop 8?
Prop 8, thank you for asking. After Prop 13 was adopted, when we got this 2% growth every year, someone in the back of the room held up their hand and said, well, if my property burns down, what happens? It goes up 2%. Well, no, that can't happen. So Prop 8 was the proposition that was adopted the next election, which says that there was a calamity, earthquake, fire, flood.
Mm-hmm.
If there is an economic downturn where the market values are underpriced, the assessor is required by law to reduce those values, review them every year when the economy rebounds to put the value back
okay.
in. So it's a Prop 8 adjustment. We saw huge reductions, not as many here, but I have a report that I'm going to show you in the presentation. But there were some cities in California that saw 65% of their single family homes have a reduction.
Hmm.
Yeah. It was pretty huge.
So we're working through the reduction credits.
Right.
And we have, you think about how much more to go, just maybe one more year?
One more year. I think you have about $72 million left out there. You have $47 million replaced this year.
Mm-hmm.
You can have one more year like that,
mm-hmm.
but it's only going to add half a percentage point to your bottom line.
Yes,
what's really adding, yeah, I mean, that. Yes, it's a little bit, but it, you know, in a city that's growing almost 9% a year,
exactly.
three of the last 4 years, you've had 9% growth. It's enough that if you under budget, it's going to help you out.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably not going to be a make or break thing.
Okay.
And the last thing I want to point out are the other positive changes, the $222.4 million. Those are properties that are having new construction value added, are bulldozed properties that are being completely built out of the ground. So roughly 2.74% of your growth had to do with that new development in town. Back in 2009 and 10 and 11, when money was short supply, people were having trouble getting loans, a lot of those projects were put on hold.
Mm-hmm.
And then 2013 and 14, they came out of the ground again. And it's really wonderful that cities these days post their building permits online so I can do research and figure out what's happening.
So somebody bought a property and they paid a lot of money for it, but they tore the house down. So now they're
and then they're adding $12 million home, and now we've got a $20 million house out there. Yeah.
But Bob, they're paying on that purchase price, even though it could be vacant land or not old house. Yeah,
well,
no, it's the purchase price of the transfer.
Right.
The
it could have had an old. It could have been that house that was $300,000,
right.
and somebody says, "I don't want to live in this." So
yeah.
they spend the $8 million for
mm-hmm.
the land. They bulldoze it. They put a $12 million property on there.
In between. Building the new property, they're paying
$8 million taxes. Yes.
On vacant land?
On vacant
yes.
land. Whatever the purchase price is.
Whatever the
property.
Purchase price is.
Okay.
Until they build it.
Until they build it and then the additional.
And
cost.
Then it gets reassessed.
If somehow they think that $8 million was overvalued and they want to go and appeal it, they'll knock themselves out.
No, but I thought
yeah.
that it would go to vacant land once they tore whatever was on
it. Yeah. It does, but if the structure on that land was a 1970 structure, it's probably got a value somewhere around $100,000 or $150,000, so it's not going to reduce the taxable value that much.
And the 225 is what, estimated?
225, where's that?
Based on the value of the properties last year in comparison of that value this year, that was the addition to the property.
Okay, well, let's walk through an example.
You're
somebody,
talking about the new construction?
Somebody sells that house for $10 million. And the buyer comes in and bulldozes it
correct.
And starts to construct a property on it.
Right.
Does it, what fits into the 225 category?
The amount of the property completed at the end of December will be a progress
so
appraisal.
There's a progress
there's
appraisal?
There's a progress appraisal. So they've
so,
got infrastructure,
so,
the walls up, nothing
right.
else. There'll
right.
be something added to the land.
There'll be something added to
the value. Correct.
Really?
And then the next year, when it's completed and the certificate of occupancy is granted, the full value of that structure is going to be, hopefully, what they took out the building permit for.
It's
and that will move
it's
out of
the
other
permit.
The other positive change category and up into the...
This one.
But it's based, your estimate is really based on the building permit.
You know, the county's estimate, the county's appraisal is usually based on the building permit.
Okay.
But
for that 222.
Yeah. I don't get the building permits, so I'm only looking at what was the value of this property last year, and it sold, and now it has this new value, which is greater than the value that they paid in the sales transaction. The only way that's going to happen is new construction value added.
So that's saying we have $225,000 worth, million worth of building permit estimated costs.
And I guess if we take our monthly building department report, where they add every month, they report the amount of new construction permits that are on there. You know, some months it's 65 million, some months it's, you know, if we added all that up, would it come up to that?
It depends on when it's final,
yeah,
because it's all rolling in.
That's a partial. That's
yeah,
at the end of the year doing a partial on.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's say that the house he was talking about, in December, it's got the walls, the foundation, the roof on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but none of the inside's been done. So there was a progress appraisal. And then it's completed in May the following year. It's completed in May. The county issues a supplemental tax bill on it.
Mm-hmm.
That supplemental tax bill gets shared with all the cities in the county. Then the following January, when the new roll is developed, that has all that value and it belongs to the town of Atherton. So it's always rolling.
Yeah.
But you're saying before the supplemental tax bill comes out, and any of us who built a house know that bill.
Yeah.
Because it's a big bill. But before that supplemental bill comes out, there's an adjustment that the assessor makes to the purchase price based on an estimated value at the end of the previous year.
Right, of what is completed on site.
I didn't know that. Okay.
Then there's a timing issue here,
it
too,
is.
A huge one. What you see in the building permit report is the cost of the building permit and the project's valuation when it's done. That's what's on the building permit. So that's not this progress one or whatever else. That could be 3 years from now before we actually see that total valuation show up on our tax rolls.
But what we're seeing here is $225 million worth of value for this past year.
Correct.
Something that was completed or partial in 2014.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It makes the city hall look small.
It does make the city hall look small.
Good thing.
Yeah. Okay. One of the first pages in the book that Robert handed out is a 5-year history of values, and the very bottom of that report shows what has been happening in the taxable value pool in each of the past 5 years. And as I mentioned as I was standing up there, there have been 3 of the past 4 years when the year-to-year change in value was 9% of the prior year. Last year was the only year in the past when it only grew 6.5%. So part of that analysis and part of those driving, as we've already talked about, the Prop 8, the minor degree, new construction, the CPI, and properties that are selling in town. Robert mentioned about the change, and this is not in your book, mentioned about the change in value going back to 2012, I believe is the date that you used.
Mm-hmm.
If you go back to 2015, the value in 2005-06, the value between 5-6 and 15-16 has doubled in this town of Atherton. So in 10 years, we've seen a complete doubling in the value for your assessed value. Your tax share doesn't change that much, so that means that you are receiving twice as much tax as you received back in 2005-06.
So it was 4.4 back in 2005-06,
right,
now it's 8.7.
8.79, so almost 8.8.
And how does that go away?
How does that go away? It could go away if there were Prop 8 adjustments.
But there's very few of those.
Very
left.
Few of those now. So realistically, it's probably not going to go away until the next recession. If I were a betting person, I would say that China's going to be the lead into that. Whatever crazy thing they do. Mr. Trump gets in, and he tells them to go screw themselves. There may be a problem. Who knows?
Oh, yeah, fix it.
Good, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
you mentioned that our tax portion hasn't changed,
correct,
meaning that 9%, we're still getting 9%.
Right.
That we got back in 2005 on a smaller number, and now we're still getting 9% on this
on
double
you that 9% is locked in after Prop 13.
Yeah.
It's not going to
change. We really, really had a hard time balancing our budgets back in 2005, 2006, 2007.
That's why you hired me.
Yes.
It's the only year that you went down 0.7%. Come on, guys. I had cities that were going down double digits, and here you are, less than 1%, and it is a crisis. Yes.
We're whining.
Well,
right,
no, if you go back to the 2000-2001 recession, we had greater reduction.
You did. I'm not showing that here. I can go back 20
but
years.
But in 2002, it went down 2%. And right. I'm sure it went down more than that in 2001.
And right. And we had a check in our reserve policy that if it went down below 2%, that we would adjust our reserve policy, I think. Do you remember that? I mean, we had a...
Yeah,
it's good that we're not in that position right now.
Looking in at each city in San Mateo County, Atherton had the fifth largest dollar change, the fourth greatest percent change in the entire county. No county, no city in the county, except for Colma, I guess, grew less than 3.9%. Colma's kind of hard pressed with all of their tax exempt property.
Menlo Park really. Shot up there, didn't they?
Commercial.
It's all there.
So did Redwood City.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Well, both of those could be, like somebody just said, commercial.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Redwood City is tremendous.
Yeah.
Park with Facebook and all that activity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, all those three cities have both commercial and residential.
Yeah,
it's
and both, you're right.
Residential.
Both those cities
yeah.
have just a residential
and
side.
Foster City.
Yeah.
Foster City
yeah.
has
yeah. a lot of commercial and industrial in Foster City.
Beat out Hillsborough and Woodside. I'm
wow. Yeah.
Yeah, we have to compare ourselves to our comparables.
Well, yeah, so if we do comparables, look at Hillsborough and Woodside.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. I mean, you know, there does.
Well,
Hillsborough did pretty
well. Well, Hillsborough did pretty well.
If we're told.
And PV? Woodside?
I think Hillsborough is a little larger than us, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
But our values long bigger.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They're larger than you in maybe square miles or
no population and number of residences.
But by value you're
we're still higher.
You're about $300 million higher by value than they are.
Well, for the last 3 years we've had the highest per property rate in the nation, and for the 3 years before that we were number two and once number three, so we've been in the top three for 7 years.
Time to sell.
This report is in your portfolio. It's fairly early in the report, and what this does is it shows the difference between values by use type. The residential properties last year there were 2,477 pieces of residential property. Same number this year. However, the value went up $673.2 million, which means that roughly 93% of all the growth in town had to do with something happening in the residential marketplace. You are a residential community. That's not a surprise to you. But what is kind of interesting is that last year it was 92.7. So you've had a consistent 93% of your growth has to do with what's happening in the residential. It hasn't waned too much. I did highlight that there is a group of properties, five of them, that are unknown. They're unknown only because the assessor has not put a use code on them. I'm pretty sure they're residential because almost everything is. And those five properties have a current value of $31 million, roughly $6 million each.
Are the parcels listed in here, in the book?
I can print them out. They are not identified specifically. I'm guessing you'd like to see that.
Yeah.
And just to review, 87.7% growth overall, 93% of it is in the residential values, and the vacant properties grew 13.6 million. That's 4.3%. That has to do with properties that have been sold for a lot more than their value. Prop 8s are
2011, you had the greatest number of properties that had been reduced by the assessor due to economic conditions and put them in market value. That was roughly 9.3% of all the properties in town. Cities that I saw last week in the northern part of the state, as I mentioned, in most cases it was 40 to 50% of the city had been reduced. So that tells you that your properties held their value even during the recession. Yes, some of them were reduced. When we got to 2014, we still had 89 homes that had been reduced. And the value that we hoped that we could recapture, if it were, if the economy were to have turned around in a heartbeat and we could have gotten it all back in 1 year, we would have hoped to got the $92.4 million in the buff color column last year. In reality, the end of the year when we could do a comparison, of the 89 properties that we started with, all but 14, 75 of them had an upward increase in their value last year. Mm. And of those 75, to the left of that, 30 of them have been fully recaptured to where they would have been had they never received the reduction. They're back on par with their brothers and sisters that never got that reduction in 2008, 9, and 10, and 11. As we start 2015, we still have 75 homes that are still sitting out there, not fully back to normal, and $71 million. We had $42 million recaptured last year. My sense is you'll probably see that again this year. Then we'll have $30 million left over. That's going to dribble in. And we may see that over a 3 or 4 year period. It's not going to be enough, as I said, to really boost your bottom line. It's just going to be enough that I probably can't help you forecast it, because it's something that's the assessors feel that their responsibility is to value property and get the property tax, not to help us in budgeting. So we don't know what's happening until after we get the roll usually in July. All right, we'll spend a few minutes on this, and that's why I did give you a copy of my notes. This report looks at the top 40 deviations. Most communities have positive and negatives on this report. All 40 of these are positive. And what I've done is taken the upper 9 or 10, and I've done research on them. The property that experienced the largest growth in town grew $17.4 million. It's at 250 Atherton Avenue, owned by King Domain Limited. It was purchased in 2014 for $25 million. And that property has been added, plus the growth between the tax years, adding $17.4 million. So it was valued at about $8 million before the sale. Residential property at 131 Britton Avenue, owned by Atherton Estates, was purchased for $20 million. And that value was enrolled. It's a $14.7 million increase. You know that one?
No.
The third one was also purchased, SF, I'm thinking probably San Francisco, B6 LLC on Park Lane, 279 Park Lane. That property was purchased for $15.3 million. The entire value has been enrolled on the land, so there's no longer any value on the improvements. As I looked on your website, the city is granted the removal of two heritage trees and the building of an accessory building and basement on site. So the assessor has not put the value of the structure on because he's waiting to see what the plans are going to cost and when they're going to start work on that.
What property is that, you're saying?
Pardon me?
Which property?
That property is at 279 Park Lane.
Oh, okay.
There are a couple of these properties that have seen some demolition. Residential property at 93 Camino de los Arboles. That property was purchased for $11.3 million. They've also seen the entire value on the land. While permission to subdivide the lot was applied for and granted, and two homes are going to get built on that site, according to your building plan. Is that legal?
That's probably three acres. That's the one that's got the fencing up on it.
Yeah.
That probably sold for $300,000.
I have to believe that after that structure is built, those two homes are probably sold. If they're not two homes owned by the same owner, they may be subdivided and sold, and those will come off as new values next year, too.
Yeah, that'll be good.
Yeah.
The
single-family residential property purchased by 70 Stern Lane at the same address. That property was purchased in 2014. The home was built in 2008 at the beginning of the real estate recession. And then a $7.1 million home was also built on that site. And at the time it was sold in 2014, they got $18.9 million for that sale. Your homes are all worth that, right? Just a couple more here. Residential property at 91 Mandarin Way was sold after construction was completed. The lot was purchased in 2013 for $3.2 million, and then in 2014 it was sold for $14.8 million. Bought a lot, built a house, and made
sounds like an easy
$11 million building.
That's further down, that's for the end of the cul-de-sac.
The one on the list that is at 420, one below where I have highlighted, is at 142 Britton Avenue. That property was valued at $362,798, and it was sold in late 2014 for $8.2 million.
So they bought that for $300,000?
Yeah.
$350,000.
Back in.
That's at the turn of Britton.
Mm-hmm. So those are the biggest of the big. Looking down the list, there was no property in the top 40 that grew less than $4 million made it on this list.
Do you know anything about 162 Isabella?
Yeah. That property of Falcon Family Holdings was revalued to reflect the sale price and the new additions on the site. It was developed in 2001 and received permission for a special structure permit to allow a garage to be located there in 2010. And that's been completed.
It's 28 million now.
But that's not being torn down.
Garage.
Yeah.
Which is that?
It didn't resell,
162.
It was just remodeled.
Revalued.
Yeah,
it's
remodeled.
Yeah, that's the 162 is about.
You know, Google is really great, but you folks have got so many trees in town that I can't zero in to see what's going on out there. And if you go at the street, you've got all these tall fences that you can't see what's behind the fence either. So I have to really rely on your knowledge of your community.
A lot of trees, a lot of fences, a lot of walls.
Last year, when property sold in the town of Atherton, they added this $330 million that we talked about, which at the bottom line ended up being about 4% of your growth. They only have 8 months of sales in the current year. There have been 62 properties that have sold this year, and the differential between the assessed value and the sale price in those first 8 months is $235.5 million. I think it's safe to say you're going to get close to that. I have 10 weeks that are not included in this scenario yet. And as we get towards the end of December, that number's going to pump up. The percent change year over year, 121%. So properties that are selling, on average, are doubling when they sell. Yeah.
In the top 40 of revenues,
yes.
Almost all those were either included in the sales totals.
That's correct. Just a couple more reports. The median sale report before the recession in 2008, the price of median price of a home that sold in 2008 in the town was $3,975,000. Year to date, 2015, the median price, $5,975,000. So those homes have increased $2 million in 6 years, mm-hmm. 7 years. Mm. The average price, so blend it in a little bit, back in 2008 was $4.9 million, and now it's $6.7 million. I'll be the first to admit that a median price is more an indicator of what's coming to market today than anything. So if the price, the homes that are coming to market today are a different quality of home, a higher price to them. Of course, this is going to go up, but you've gone up every year since 2010. But you hit your bottom at $3,125,000 in 2009, and it never looked back. And now the feel-good report. This report looks at every, is alphabetical, looks at every city in the county, and the four cities above you, Colma, East PA, Brisbane, and Daly City, are the only cities that have not currently experienced a sale price that exceeds the price they had in the bubble. Every other city has.
Mm.
In Santa Clara County, I believe Gilroy and Morgan Hill are the only two cities that have a good peak. Reading CoreLogic, which took over DataQuick, and when they're talking about the Bay Area, they comment that there are a number of counties, don't name them, where the current median price is pretty much priced the regular purchaser on the marketplace.
Mm. How many counties?
They didn't mention, they just said in the Bay Area. There are a number of counties, is how they put it. And you know, I see some of that in, let's say, Piedmont in Alameda County, not elsewhere in Alameda County. Contra Costa County, I see some of that. I see some of that in Marin County, certainly here. And I'm not sure, other than Atherton, I'm not sure that I would have thought that San Bruno, for instance, would have a median price in excess of the bubble price. But it is just because people can't afford to live in, say, San Carlos, they go to the next place where they can afford to live. And it's just boosting the prices throughout. And I don't believe it's a bubble. People that are buying these properties can afford it, or they're getting loans like they can afford it. They're not the kind of loans that were given back in the early 2000s. So it's just an unavailability of homes that was available back in 2003 and 2004. And looking to 16-17, I've already mentioned that the CPI is not going to be 2%. Our calculation just in the first 8 months is that you're going to have about 3% added to your bottom line from sales. That's probably going to approach 4-4.5% like you had this year. Plus the 5% CPI, that gets you at 5.5%. Prop 8s will add another 0.5 percentage point. So out of the gate, no new construction, 6%. New construction, you know, if you get from your building apartment the completed new construction granted between January 2015 and, let's say, November 2015, county a month to work all of those, that will tell us what kind of a sweep we're going to get from new construction to the bottom line. Yes?
You said it took about $80 million in change of appraised value. Well, that's to equal 0.5%, you said?
No, right now it's 88 for the full percent because you had $7 million added to your bottom line in 2015-16. In 2014-15, you have a total of $8 billion. Now you've got $8.7 billion. So it's taking a little bit more to move you up a percentage point now. Follow me?
So the 240 million is what I'm, the 235.
It's not, yes, 235 is 2.9%. Divide by
2.9%.
Okay, yeah, 2.9% plus 1.5 for the CPI plus 0.5% for the crop base. That gets us to 5. And then we'll have to look at your new construction. Any questions?
Barbara, I think there's a typo on your lead-in document. It should say fiscal year 14, the bottom paragraph on the front page. It should say fiscal year 14-15 to 15-16.
Yes, sorry. Yep, 14-15 where it says 13-14, it should be 14-15, and 14-15 should be 15-16.
February is when we send our federal fund revenue spreadsheet. We're working on a 5-year projection document which is something that we haven't provided in the past, that will give you the ability to plug in things you know that are being built coming down the line to start forecasting multiple years.
So how do we account for, on this sheet here, it talks about the positive changes that come in at year end with the assessor.
Mm-hmm.
How do we account for that? If we're tracking building permits and completed, is there a portion of that that we're already seeing?
Probably not that much.
Okay.
No, if you have infrastructure, if you've got the boards up, that is not the major. These homes are being built with marble and a lot of amenities inside that comes to the bottom line after it's completed. And those are not going to be included here. So that may be 10% of the overall value of the project in my estimation.
All right, so if we track from January to November what our completed projects are for construction purposes, let's say that's...
And I'm not talking about somebody adding a new roof. I'm talking
right.
about something coming
new,
out of the ground. You
new
know?
Homes, right. New certificates of occupancy. A portion of that, though, was going to be in that other positive changes. So those projects rolled online over the last year and a half to 2 years.
Correct.
As they moved along. So we would have to deduct from that amount some number.
I would take 10-15% off your number.
10-15? Okay.
Yeah, I think we'll be good with that.
So we're in this report.
Yes.
It's a very complete report. Is did you transfer all these or translate all these property values into a net tax number excluding excess ERIP?
The revenue report. Page 27.
Yeah.
So our estimate of the general fund revenue.
Yeah.
Put a sticky note there. Yeah. And we did not subtract the $63,000 that the county of San Mateo charges you to administer. We note it there because a lot of our clients book that separately, so we just
right.
note it so that you don't.
Take it as additional
27.
Yeah.
So wait, could you explain that?
Which?
What are we looking at?
This is the revenue report. What we do is we know the values that are assigned to your secured roll, your utility roll, and your unsecured roll. Value times 1% times your weighted share of the 1% in the tax rate areas generates revenue that we can calculate. And then the bottom line, you have an ERAF shift
at $1.6 million.
That's the amount you're giving because you're required to give ERAF to the county. And then after the schools, which are mostly basic aid, are already whole and your VLF in lieu has been paid back to you, any revenue that is in excess comes back to you as excess for ERAF.
ERAF, right.
It used to also be used to the fund the triple flip. That's sunsetted. So there's going to be more, in my opinion, more of this revenue coming back because there are less obligations being called on now.
What did we get back last year? We got back $1.6 million, didn't we?
ERAF? No, $1.020 million. No, $1.125 million.
$1.125 million.
Yeah, $1.125 million. We got an ERAF, excess ERAF.
Yeah.
And we've always budgeted about
$1.2 million for this
no.
year.
This year we did $1.2 million.
Yeah.
Previous years, it was less. It was always 700, and then 1 year we did. It was always 700,000.
But that's when we budgeted it as part of our revenue expectation above the line.
Yeah.
We're not doing that anymore either.
Yeah. Now we're including it below, and then we're just using that component to pay off, you know, long term liabilities or any other
capital project.
Yeah.
But last year we made a payment of $1.698 million in ERAF and got back $1.12 million. Is that
they deduct that?
They deduct
from
that tax sum. I'm sorry, a tax summary level. So they know how much you owe because they've got a separate calculation that's going on. So if they didn't do that, you would receive $9,033,000.
Right,
okay?
I see that.
But then at the tax summary level, they suck that off. They retain it. They're supposed to use.
Explain when that started again for the rest of the group. You already explained it to me.
Mm-hmm.
ERAF?
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 Yeah.
Oh.
When they started stealing the money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a state.
Yes. Back in 1992-93, the state couldn't balance its budget. Remember, after Prop 13 was adopted, a lot of cities got bailed out because Prop 13 harmed you. So the state said, we have some extra money here. We're going to give it to the cities, counties, special districts to help you balance your budgets. So now we get down to 1992, the state can't balance their budget, and they go, remember that money we gave you back then? We're going to take it back. You have no right to keep it. So the first year, they took 9% of what you received in 1991-92, shifted that back to the state as ERAP, thinking they could balance their budget on that. Couldn't do it. So the next year, they took more. It was an additional up to about 25% of your allocation with some population figures and some other calculations involved, and retained that. And that was to be used, was to go to the schools, because if it went to the schools who didn't have enough property tax to pay the ADA, then the state could keep its ADA. So it was sort of shifting the revenue back to the state so they could balance their budget. They were able to balance their budget in 93-4 and beyond, until the vehicle license in lieu got taken away, and then Ray Davis got recalled, and then we started down with ARM. So what happens now is the state, the county still retains your share. They've been taking it forward with growth every year since 1972-3. And after they take it, they say, okay, which schools are not collecting enough property tax to completely augment the student cost? Those schools get an ERAP amount. And whatever's left over is used to pay triple flip, which no longer exists. And then the VLF that came in, VLF and LU that came in 2004-05, it's used to pay that. And then anything left over at the end of the day comes back to the original taxing entities.
But it's a constant target at the state level.
Right. Yeah.
And there's only three counties in the state that get excess ERAP.
Yeah, Marin, Napa, and San Mateo.
Yeah.
And yes, go
for it. It's because the property values in those jurisdictions have gone up, and the schools are able to meet their obligation, and then
there's some cities that, like Irvine, have come really close, and it actually may happen, where a couple of school districts in Irvine, because of the growth there, are getting really close to having a basic aid school system. And when that happens, then again, the ERAP is all pooled countywide. So it doesn't just come back to the city of Irvine, it's going to get distributed to everybody if they don't have any basic aid schools, because that's the only way they can get money back to you.
Yeah. It's a constant state target. They're going to figure out a way to take
it.
Oh, yeah.
The one way that they can change that is just increase the funding formula for the schools.
Yeah.
And then it so the schools require more money, so that excess ERAP will be used more to pay it down.
Which would be wise. I mean, a lot of school districts are suffering.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So that's.
Any other questions from Ms. Cohen?
Thank you. It's always fun to come here.
Great summary.
You're a cornucopia of information.
Cornucopia,
thank
that's a great
so
word.
Much.
That's a big word.
That's a big word. I don't want to spell it.
Item 5 on the agenda. The ad hoc finance committee process that we talked about last meeting. I met with Robert and then subsequently the boss over here to kind of come up with something. And we developed something that I feel comfortable with, but I think it needs to be good housekeeping seal of approval for the rest of it. Robert's got a typical weekly check run there. And that was kind of the basis for our analysis. If I remember correctly, I had something like 45 checks in.
Yes, about 40 checks.
40 checks. So the number of checks in a weekly check run can be less, it can be significantly more, but I would imagine that you're running somewhere on average in the 60 to 70 checks a run.
Probably, on a good one, probably a week, about 60 checks per week.
So
about 240 a month.
gives you a feel for the number of transactions. I looked at all the supporting paperwork that comes with the check, which some of you may want to look at. I mean, if it's, you have the simple, straightforward ones where a PO is issued for $50 and we get a bill for $50 and we write a check for $50. Those are kind of straightforward. There are others where various things can happen. We have a bunch of invoices from a vendor. We don't ever write a bunch of checks. We write a single check that week.
Right, for the vendor? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you might have numerous POs associated with that check. But again, all the amounts line up, it's kind of a thing. Then you have the more complicated transactions where the council has approved a large expenditure. The example in that pile that would be of interest maybe is the company that's doing the feasibility details on the new
Civic Center.
Mm-hmm. So there's a budget of $40,000 in round numbers.
It's a bigger number, but that check I think was almost 40, about I think 32.
Yeah, checks. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sorry, but there's a budget lump right there. So what they did do, and they didn't do it for me, they just do it because they're pretty organized, is they keep a running total of what they've, because there's only one PO sitting back here somewhere for that amount.
Uh-huh.
So they each check run, they update the running totals, as well as how it's charged out. For example, in that the scenario I'm talking about, some of it gets charged to the library guys and some of it gets charged to the building department. I guess the rest gets charged to the general fund.
It's all in the facilities fund, 506,
yeah.
But there are different categories within that fund.
So the bottom line is between the POs, which they attach a copy of the PO to every one of these transactions, and the running totals that they keep on the on a large ongoing transactions. Another example might be Chevron
card.
So most everything you need actually to figure out if we're abiding by the purchasing policy and if we're staying within our budget means, and all the I's and dotted and T's crossed is in that pile of paper. So last meeting, they discussed looking at something like this before it goes to George for signature. I kind of like it better that we do it after the fact. And we've settled somewhat arbitrarily on auditing 25 transactions out of the check run. All the transactions that are above $5,000, five transactions that are below $5,000, routine transactions, and the balance to be in between. That would, if we do this once a quarter, that would be 100 transactions out of 4,000 transactions, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not 5 or 10%, which I think would be burdensome for maybe everybody, but at least we're looking at 1 or 2% of the transactions.
Mm-hmm.
So as I, again, from going through this, we didn't actually do an audit. We were trying to figure out how to do the audit. When whoever does it gets through the pile, the 25 transactions that he's circled on the cover sheet, he's probably going to be happy with 20 of them, maybe 23 of them, I don't know. He's going to have a few questions, and that's when he'll take staff time to find out, get the answers to the questions, and feel good about everything and be able to report back to the committee that we did this quarter's audit and everything was great or one thing wasn't great, whatever it might be. The only change that Robert agreed to make that makes this a little more typically they file these about as fast as the checks get signed.
And that's good policy to do that, because you don't want paper laying around.
Yes, filing is good. So he's agreed to keep two such piles out there, and whoever's going to do the audit could call and say, I'd like to come over and do an audit, and there'll be the last two check runs will be there, and in this case me, I'll grab one, and he can file the other one. I'll do my 25 transactions out of that, and then we're done for the quarter. We would do this once a quarter, unannounced, just with a phone call. And if, you know, if they're commingling funds or writing phony checks, they'll say, we can't do it this week.
We're like, oh, that bad, we filed it.
I'm going to Hawaii.
No, and we settled that, you know.
You're in school.
We picked 2 weeks worth of batches. That way, you know, if a week goes by and there's no call, then that last week we file, and then we keep the next week.
Yeah.
And it's once it's until that quarter gets audited, and then we'll set up the process again. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. That way, it keeps the integrity of the audit.
Mm-hmm.
That way, here you go, yeah, come see him. And he'll come in, you know, to the conference room and look through them, and as a circle them, check them. If he has any questions, wants to look at a PO or anything, he would ask us, and we could go further into the detail. And then I think we said once he's audited, what he can do is sign off on that check.
That batch that they
audited. Mm-hmm. So when the auditors come in, they can... We can tell them these were the dates that, you know, our ad hoc committee audited our AP disbursements, and they can see that there's a signature there and that they did audit and spot check, and it's an added layer of our internal mm-hmm. control.
Sounds a good idea.
Yeah.
Any suggestions to make it better? I mean, I may have some suggestions after the first.
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think you're the guy on the ground, so you kind of approach.
I think it sounds like a good plan. My only concern at the last meeting that was going to be too burdensome on you or, you know, whoever's going to do it. And it doesn't sound like it's going to be four times a year. You know,
well, you're not in town all the time, Bob. So.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that when we schedule the next meeting.
He can ride from the golf course to get here.
Which is even better. I'm like, Mr. Polito's out of town for his next 3 weeks. Those things are just those batches are just gonna sit right there in the corner. No, just kidding. No, I think if we could do, you know, four times a year, once a quarter, and then as we go through the process, if there's things that we see, maybe we can change the, you know, either procedures or processes. But I think as we went through that last week, when we were going through the process, I think we figured. I think it was just getting through the whole process, what we're looking at,
right.
And getting him up to speed of what is what. And then we can go, you know, we kind of figured, okay, this is the best process to do. Then as we go forward, as we see any things or something that we need to change, we can discuss it and then bring it back to the committee and say we changed this process a little bit or, you know. And then we'll report back at the next committee the audit. Whatever audits occurred in that quarter or those quarters, we'll report back. And
well, sounds good.
Okay.
What are the signatory levels of a, you know, when did checks move up the chain to get multiple signatures, or who can approve what?
At first, it goes, the department heads can sign off on their department purchases, but check signatures require the city manager and myself. Other signers are the city clerk and the mayor and vice mayor. And so all checks require two signatures, and the process ends with me and then final with him, with George signing off on the batch, I mean on the checks, and I sign off and then commit the batch. So there's an extensive process that we go through, but the department heads have, as long as it's within their budget and it's within the purchasing policy,
uh-huh.
they can make purchases. But the signature levels at the forum.
Yeah.
But they don't sign checks, just
no,
to be clear.
No.
They just can
approve
the,
yeah,
the
mm-hmm.
voucher to be
right. You need to know that it wasn't that way before. There was an extensive audit and things done here some number of years ago,
yeah.
Which actually put in a purchasing plan and restricted. methodology, which, as long as I've been sitting in this committee since it got started, has been followed and verified by the audit group every year. So it's really pretty tight.
Oh, you got
it. Yeah, that was handed out. Send that out again. That was included in our packet in our September meeting. So there's a process that's in place, and we do follow that. All POs, purchase orders, to make a purchase, anything over $1,000 requires a purchase order, and the purchase orders are only given through the finance department.
Okay.
So a department has to initiate a purchase requisition, which goes through the department head. Then it goes to the city manager,
uh-huh.
And then once that is signed by the two department head and the city manager, it comes to the finance department. Then we see that that's been approved.
Uh-huh.
Then we issue a purchase order. So the purchase order can only come from us. So
yeah.
No one can make a purchase without the final say with a purchase order assigned by us, by the finance department.
Which again is a major change from what was going on some number of years ago.
Okay.
So our city manager is going to be gone for a couple of weeks.
Yes.
Now, so the city clerk and finance director will be signing checks.
Yes, and you'll have a, within the city manager's written report on your November council meeting, you'll have just a statement from me saying that Teresa will serve as the acting city manager while I'm gone.
Okay.
And so by concurrent minute order, the council approves that process
Good.
For that 2 weeks.
Okay.
So then Robert's got somebody he can
yeah.
use in that role.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
She has some experience in
that.
She does.
Yeah.
She does.
Definitely. So, yeah.
So, by fire.
Yeah.
Okay.
Jump in.
The next item on the agenda is an update on where we stand as of September 30th for income expenses or fund balances.
Yes. Before you, I wanted to include our end of our first quarter financial report for the townwide for the whole city. So in this report, you'll see the whole fund balances, total fund balances for the town. So the beginning fund balance was 35.2 million, and the ending fund balance is 31.4 million. We have a negative change of 3.7 million. I think it should be right here. You can tell here's the beginning, here's the end. That's just the pie that's missing. Yes. And so there's no, I don't think there should be any caution, because the biggest component of the town is property taxes. And we receive our property taxes not till the end of December, early January. We get our first installment, and then we get our second installment in April and May of property taxes. And property taxes are 70% of our total yearly revenue in the general fund. So that's, we're kind of, you can see in the general fund, I'm gonna start with the general fund, we had revenues of 1.1 million and expenditures of 3.4 million. And so right now we're about, I think we're, you know, we have 1.1 million of revenues, and our total revenue projection for the year is 13.8 million. So we're about 7.9% right now in revenues. And again, it's attributed to property taxes being a major component that we have yet to receive. So this diagram you'll see is just kind of giving you an eye view of what the total fund revenue is. We're about 13.8 million in revenue, and our total property taxes, including in this diagram, I included 9.6 million is total property taxes, and ERAF is 1.2 million of that. So you'll see our reflection of this chart that shows that 70% of our total revenue of the 13.8 million, about 9.6 million of that is attributed to property taxes. And then sales tax, I kind of,
hey, Robert, just so I understand, though, in the report that we just saw, was basically, wasn't the number much less than this, though? Kind of like 7.7 plus if we get the ERAP back?
It was.
Okay.
Yeah, so if we back out the of this 9.6 million, we back out 1.2 million of it, you'll get closer to the actual property taxes.
Uh-huh.
And we had budgeted $6.6 million, and that's secured and unsecured taxes. And in this report sheet we had just talked about with Paula, it shows that we're estimating $7.3 million.
Yeah.
So we're gonna have an upswing if it picks up correctly, about $600,000 additional in secured property taxes. So yes. So this $9.6 million of that, and I have it's on my sheet. If you look at the financial report, there's a revenue summary. So the revenue component, there you go. So you can see our property taxes. So our budget of property taxes was $6.6 million, which is the secured component that we were discussing with Paula. And ERAF is $1.2 million. $904,000 is property tax in lieu. That's what our budget was. Other property taxes, $946,000. That is includes unsecured property taxes, and that also includes our document transfer tax. So right now we've only received $100,000, and that's in the other property tax category. Uh-huh. So of that component, if you take the $6.6 million, the $1.2 million, and the other property tax in lieu, you'll get the 9.6.
Got you. Okay, got it.
What we have.
What is the property tax in lieu?
In lieu, VLF, and that's the vehicle license fee. And so that's what Paul was mentioning. In 2004 and 5, that's where the state took vehicle license fee, and because there was more vehicle license fees.
Which traditionally went to us.
Right. And they swapped it with property tax fees, with property taxes. Well, what ended up happening was property taxes started going up, and the VLF ended up not being enough. So what do? They take money from the ERAF, which is our own money, to supplement the VLF that they were getting.
We're paying ourselves.
Yeah, basically, right. So it's there, that pot of money that they take from us is that same pot of money we get back when the state has taken what they needed. And so that just keeps going on in revolving doors. So we still get that property tax in lieu. It's still a category that is given to us through the from the county. So that's still calculated separately for our town. And then so kind of looking at sales tax right now, we're at $18,755. That's just at the first quarter. The biggest thing to probably note is franchise fees. We're at $834,000 is our budget. We received $53,000. Our biggest franchise fees are garbage, cable, PG&E, and water. And right now we've only received $53,000. And I think the reason for that, some of the fees we get quarterly. Garbage we get every month, but PG&E and Cal Water, we don't receive those till March and April as a whole, and then everything else, the cable franchise fees, we get every quarter. So that it's kind of, it trickle in.
What percentage of our property tax profit do we receive in December?
We receive 50%.
And the rest comes in April.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So, and it's kind of, we projected $6.6 million in property taxes, and it looks like we could be about $7.3 million. So we're gonna, and like Paula said earlier, it doesn't hurt those that budget, not conservatively, but don't budget for these increases. We didn't budget for these huge increases, so it's a windfall for us. But it's something
think
that
about
we could
potholes we could fill. My favorite project.
Yes. So, I mean, it's a good problem to have, and I think, as you start to see your property taxes have been increasing, and it has in three of the last 4 years, it's about 9% our property tax are increased. So I think by December, at the end of December, early January, if we get half of our property taxes, we'll kind of have an understanding of where we're going to end up, and hopefully, we'll be an additional positive about $600,000 just on the property tax itself. And that's not to mention ERAF. I think ERAF, we budgeted $1.2 million. That could come in higher, and we normally use ERAF as a component below the line, and we we use that to augment either capital projects or funded liabilities. The last couple of years, we've contributed to our OPEB. Last year, it's in this report. Of the $1.125 million that we received, $680,000 went to OPEB. The remaining about $444,000 went to the workers' comp. So we're using ERAF as a one-time kind of revenue source, because eventually, like George was saying, it's a moving target. And and I think in my conversations with the county, that's something we always hear, it's going to go away, it's going to go away. It's not going to go away overnight, but eventually, over time, it'll decrease and decrease. But I think we're being prudent, just like other agencies are being prudent in using it as a, not as an operational revenue, but in a revenue stream to augment one-time projects going forward.
Yeah.
We haven't discussed what to use the 15-16.
No, and I think that once January, I was told that January we should get, the ERAF component should come in January. And once we get that, and we'll begin, and that'll start with mid-year budget, and then as we get into budget discussions, we'll carry on. We'll, like we have in the past, we'll say, okay, this is what we received in 15-16 in ERAF. We'll bring the council opportunities and ideas of what to use it for, and we'll do that again. We'll budget those monies into this 16-17 budget year. So this year, we ended up using, like I said, $1.1 million, we used it for OPEB, and then we paid off our negative equity. We had negative equity in our workers' comp fund, so we went to pay that off using that $1.1 million
this
year.
These numbers look pretty puny,
right?
But it's only first quarter numbers,
yes.
Compared to what? I mean, if you look at the building department revenue projections of $1,660,000, and you're at $500,000, so.
Right.
If you consider it's only the first quarter, we've got three more quarters, we'll probably make that.
You have to look at the percentages.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, we're at 30%.
The only percentage that jumps out at me is the police percentage. We're at 33% of spend for 25% of the time.
Yeah, that's a little...
On expenditures?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then one of that component is also, I think... It was in here as well, as we've had our unfunded liability for PERS. We paid that amount up front, and so that's kind of in there.
I saw that description in the language.
Yes.
That applies across the board, but so that has a big impact.
Yeah,
on
so PD's was $344,000, and I think the miscellaneous, all the other departments was a total of like $116,000, $114,000.
So. I asked a question on capital expenditures. I mean, it's off the subject, but
that's fine.
Under streets and sidewalks up at the top, we've got $625,000 budgeted streetlight replacement.
Yeah.
And then down at miscellaneous, we have this almost the same thing again with nothing budgeted. Series streetlight repair project. Are they
I will clean that up. I think because with some projects, some capital projects have multiple funding sources, and
right,
this,
I'm just curious,
yeah, and this was a funding source that we typically how it was being used. So anything that is zero, these
yeah,
on the miscellaneous.
My query was, I guess we have some funding under miscellaneous other. None of them have any funding,
right.
So are they real projects or no?
Right.
But in general, I think we look really in pretty good shape.
Yeah. I mean, and I wanted to kind of give you all this kind of summary just to kind of see where we're at right now. I mean, we have a budget, we have projects that we are kind of in they're in the pipeline, but some of our capital projects are spring driven also as well. So they ramp up next when the spring begins, spring and summer.
Is there any kind of money that's been put away for the, and it looks like you have budget kind of floating around, excess budget. But for El Nino, any kind of projections of how that might impact the city at all?
So we do have a storm readiness budget within the Public Works Department, and they start that, they plan that every year for the rainy season.
Mm-hmm.
And they start that effort in September and August when they start to clear drains, and they've got to be completely done by mid-October, October 15th, for the Regional Water Quality Control Board requirements, and that goes through March. So they have a budget for that built in.
I have another question. How does somebody initiate a potential capital improvement project? let's say I wanted to replace the retaining, the sound wall on El Camino next to Lloyden Park, where somebody actually backed into the wall and had to replace with wood. How does that project get initiated?
I thought that was privately funded.
You know that better. You took a ride with me.
You could just send a note into to me and
okay.
Process
yeah.
of public
curious.
Works and all that. I did want to make a note. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I had a couple questions about this list. So I just don't recall the budget discussion exactly. So for the series street lighting, are we expecting that to be about a $600,000 project?
There's a component of it that is, no, there's a component of that that is project management and RFP and all that sort of stuff. The actual construction component of it is less than 600K. But that was an engineer's estimate that showed up when we sent the RFP out. I don't recall what it was exactly, though. But that RFP is on the street.
So
yeah.
The RFP is on the street now.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean
that
the budget will be spent. And it's correct. It was a budget that
no,
we
No, this is budgeted funds, mm-hmm. but it just gives me an opportunity to ask some questions about
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm.
So on the El Camino Real, the 200K
mm-hmm.
that's allocated, what is that?
The complete street study?
A complete street study. That was part of the CIP project this year.
Okay. And the Marsh Road repair project, is the 700K, that's a project we're expecting to launch in as soon as the rainy season ends.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a much bigger project than 700K.
Yeah.
Right.
So is that just this fiscal year's piece of that project, maybe assuming what we've got?
Yes,
two
sir.
And a half months in it this year, and
right.
yes, yeah,
but it's about a 6 month project, right? That makes me think that.
Well, the bid, once we put it on the street, the bid, which will be hopefully after we complete this whole 60-day hearing thing.
Oh wait, I thought we had a bid. I thought we had. We
no.
just did the engineering piece
yes.
of it.
We haven't done the plans and specs yet and put it on the street. We have to wait until we get the permits to do that.
Oh, we're not going
to
start in April then.
Correct. It keeps getting pushed over multiple years because of this delay we're having.
But it's a 6 month project, and we can't do it based on the permit, on the application for the permit. We can't
Correct.
Do it during the rainy season.
Correct.
So if we don't start it, by probably June,
right?
We're not going to get it done this year.
Correct. So it'll again span multiple years.
We'll carry it forward, and I think that's what we did this year in the CIP. In looking at the CIP booklet within the budget, there was in the CIP program, there were some carryover funds, and then it showed the project.
No, I know, I understand, I totally understand that, but I'm thinking we're going to disrupt Marsh Road, and I guess we're just going to leave it in process. It's okay.
It's got to be planned in time.
Not
in school.
Sure how that's going to work.
Yeah, it's a big project.
And I take it that the under the community buildings, the distinction between the library and the civic center is just a fund allocation issue.
Yes.
Yeah, and then the 631 and the 1.7 is just the allocation component.
And I wanted to note there's a revenue side and an expenditure side of this spreadsheet. And Robert, on the revenue side, we have a total revenues received $5.8 million. You seeing that? You might explain that a portion of that $5.8 million is transfers from...
Right. Transfers from the... If you recall, there was a transfers out of $4.2 million. And in my report, I had mentioned that through the budget process that $4.2 million includes $680,000 that was the OPEB contribution, $631,000 was the equity reserve component, $614,000 was for the capital projects, studies and completions for the Civic Center, and some current facilities and park master plan project, and then the remaining amount of that $4.2 million. The council went ahead and did a transfer of about $2.3 million to the CIP fund for future unidentified projects. So, as George was saying, this $5.8 million if you look at the capital improvement project fund, see how it's 2.9 million. That includes the 2,039,000 that the council moved for future capital projects, and also 614,000 for the town master plan, the continuing stuff. So that's that 2.9 million is part of that transfers out. Also, it's in the 702,000 for workers' compensation fund. 631,000 is part of that 702,000. That's the transfers in from the general fund. And the same thing for the employee benefit fund of 824,000. 680 of that is the OPEB component that was transferred in from the general fund. So,
which came from the 1.2 that we had.
The 1.1, exactly. 1.4. So to the breakdown that you raffed, it was 1.125. 680,000 of that went to OPEB. The remaining 444,316 went to the negative equity of workers' comp. But we needed about 631 for workers' comp, so there was an additional 180,000 that was from the unallocated component of the general fund that went, that we
is that from general liability fund? Is that
Went into the workers' compensation fund.
Okay.
And then the
from the general fund.
Yeah, no, I understand that. And that's why the percentages are higher than the 25%. But why is the general liability fund higher? That's a 35%.
Oh, because on the general liability, we pay up front the liability insurance. We pay it always in July. So that's why it just shows higher. So we pay it higher than when we get the charge.
Six months premium or 12 months premium?
Liability is, I think it might be the whole year. It's the whole year. Because our liability is...
Why is there such a big difference between what we spend and what the budget is?
On the general liability, because we have a reserve in there component for $100,000. We budget four cases at $25,000 each. That's our self retention.
Is that administered by the same guys that do the workers' comp?
No, that's ABAC.
So the only other sort of items that jump out at you on the revenues side in terms of the percentages are business licenses are pretty far up. I'm wondering why that is, and the park, which I pretty much understand why that is. We probably under budgeted for revenue on the park.
I think the park, I think it's just starting to pick up. I think last year was our first full year with Catering by Dana, you know, promoting the park and stuff, and I think people, the word got out, and I think there's just been more bookings.
It's a busier season.
Right.
You're also booking revenue from the summer season, spring season.
And weddings are picking up. I think it's just
But I think we just under budgeted. It's not a big deal. The park, by the way, when you look at the numbers in terms of what the total expenses we have on the park versus the revenues compared to the last 5 years, we're in. It's off the charts in terms of how good shape we're in.
We have a tennis program now too, right?
Right.
And the tennis program might, because he did pay the year. Right.
And that's out of the tennis fund, exactly. So it's
also
in there.
We started the rental program, and that which had been canceled for.
Yeah, no, that's right.
Years.
So
yeah,
it's great. We just under budgeted. But what about on the business licenses? Is there something that skews that?
No, I think the business license, part of it could be skewed. I think everybody that's a continued business license contractor here, they renew every year in July, at the end of June.
So there's an early renewal.
Mm-hmm. And then I think also is, I mean, as you can see, the construction that's going on, a lot of our business licenses are subcontractors and contractors. So if there's more building construction, I think that they're more and more pulling permits, new ones, I think, are pulling business licenses.
Okay. Makes sense.
And then,
good news is all these are really positive numbers.
Yeah.
And it looks, you know, like.
Yeah.
Robert, you have your head around it all.
That's a true statement. It's great to see you be as fluid with these numbers as you are.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Appreciate it. Yeah, it's my job, so just trying to. And it's good. I think we're doing a lot of things. I think in the last couple of years, we've been very diligent, and a lot of projects been going on, a lot of we've done some, you know, revenue alternative, we've looked at different revenue streams, we've had a lot of programs at Civic Center, a lot of capital projects have starting to take place, and you know, it's a...
You just call them potholes when you're talking
potholes. Yeah.
You do a good job,
beat
Robert.
That drum.
On your minutes, you could probably use some more paragraph.
Oh, I will. I'm sorry. I'll break them up.
It's one long run on set.
I'll break them up.
That?
Yeah, I'll break them up. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. You know,
okay.
Looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Robert.
You're welcome.
Next meeting day. Was tentative for January 12th.
Oh,
it's.
Wow.
That's pretty exciting.
I've always wanted, as an engineer kind of guy, I've always wanted to see it. So I can't do January 12th, but that doesn't mean we can't meet without me.
We do
well,
have a vice chair, you know.
But
we also had the ability to look at other dates.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's look at other dates. So I know probably. January 5th is definitely out of the question, I think, because it's right after the holiday, too close.
What about the 19th?
The 19th, we could do the 19th. The 18th is Martin Luther King Day, so I'm fine with it. It's the day after a holiday. I have no problem doing the 19th. It's just however the committee... Will you be back then, Mr. Polito, or...?
The 19th works for me.
Works for me too. Mm.
Well, those that aren't here don't get a vote.
Right? Okay.
Okay.
Does that work for you?
It's time, Mr. Lee, down. He's not allowed to get on an airplane. For Asia.
Right? So hopefully yes, he's here.
As I seen you?
Yep. Nice. Oh, so we're going to motion to adjourn?
Or? Oh, yeah. I'll do that, but I'm so, okay. Any last